Hello, Homewood family. My name is Tom Seberg. I am the chair of the Elder Board for this year. And as we go through this time of pandemic and crisis, and we celebrate following the Lord, I wanted to just share a verse of scripture that really has meant something to me during times of uncertainty. And this comes from the book of Daniel. And this is when Daniel was getting the prayer from Nebuchadnezzar interpreted. And this is what he says in Daniel chapter 2, beginning of verse 20. Let the name of God be blessed forever and ever, for wisdom and power belong to him. It is he who changes the times and the epochs. He removes kings and he establishes kings. He gives wisdom to wise men and knowledge to men of understanding. It is he who reveals the profound and hidden things. He knows what is in the darkness, and light dwells with him. And as we look at what's going on in our world being turned upside down, it is so assuring to know that God is completely in control. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for this day that you've given us. We thank you for your provision. We thank you for your omnipotence and omnipresence. We thank you for your love for us. And we just ask that you would continually guide us in wisdom and in knowledge and understanding. We thank you and we trust you for your love for us, your provision for us in the days to come, and the understanding that we will walk through this with you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Spirit of the living God, Spirit of changes what we see and what we see. It's changing everything. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of everything else can wait. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, come now and breathe upon our hearts. Come now and have your way. It's when you speak, when you move, when you do what only you can do.
It changes us, changes what we see. Changes what we see, what we see.
When you move all our fears. When you move us to tears.
Let's go back into Jesus' pep talk and discover some more truths that can support and strengthen us in troubled times. When you find yourself delving into a new topic, one that you need to research and learn some things about, and yet you're a bit intimidated, you're not sure if you understand what you're looking into, it's tough at first, isn't it? You feel like it's stretching your mind more than it can handle. But the truth is, you've got to jump in somewhere. Realizing that the things you're exposing yourself to, you're probably going to need to hear again and again to really understand. This is what happens in Jesus' pep talk here in chapter 14, beginning in verse 15. There's some concepts that Jesus wants his disciples to grasp. And these are the kind of concepts that he's going to have to go over with them again and again. And they're going to, first time around, grasp a little bit of it, but they'll have to go deeper and deeper and deeper. And that's exactly what happens. But still, there has to be a first time. So let's look at these concepts that Jesus introduced. They're new thoughts to them. The first novel thought in chapter 14, verse 15, has to do with loving Jesus. Now, we realize Jesus already has given them that new commandment in chapter 13, verses 34 and 35, that new commandment to love one another even as he had loved them. I think it's important for us as followers of Christ right now, as we're going through this coronavirus and the crisis, one practical way that we can love one another is to realize we've got different convictions about these issues. Some of you have very strong feelings and convictions about what you should be doing and how we should re-enter again, trying to move back into normalcy. And I just encourage you in the language of Romans chapter 14, verses 1 and 3, that if you have those kind of strong convictions, don't judge your fellow brothers and sisters who don't have those same strong convictions. But I would also encourage those of you who are more lenient, you're not as staunch and strong in your convictions, you need to be careful that you don't hold with contempt those brothers and sisters who have stronger convictions than you do. A very practical way that we can love one another as Jesus called us to. What he's added now, though, is to love him. And he says in verse 15, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. As back then, same is true today, there's many people who would claim that they love Jesus. But how do we know it? And Jesus is saying, if you love me, you'll obey me. You'll keep my commandments. That's the mark that you indeed do love me. And so that's what he charges them with them here. And this is a good bridge verse because what has gone before, Jesus talked about those who will do greater works in answer to prayer. And these are the kind of people who will see greater works done in Jesus' name. But it bridges also to the thought that how and I can possibly do this? How can I love Jesus and keep his commandments? I need divine help. And so it bridges what follows. And Jesus introduces another concept in the next verse. I guess we should say a permanent companion, because it's not just a concept, but it's a person. And it's a permanent companion that he talks about in verses 16 and beginning in verse 17. And again, this is a new thought to these followers of Christ. Jesus says, I will ask the Father. In verse 13 and 14, the original language, the word asked, was an inferior talking to a superior. The word it's used here is an equal talking to an equal. Jesus, as an equal with the Father, will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper. The original language has the word another, which means another of the same kind as I am. Not another of a different kind, but the same kind. And he calls him a helper, one who will be called alongside to help his followers, whatever the need might be. Well, what these disciples have known is Jesus' presence as their helper. Now, he's going to go back to the Father, and in a different way, he'll still be a helper. 1 John chapter 2, verse 1 uses the same Greek term for helper here, where it calls Jesus our advocate. He's our spiritual representative before the Father. When we sin, there he is as our helper. He's already offered a sacrifice to cover those sins that we can be forgiven. But now we're getting another helper just like Jesus. It's another person that's being sent, and it's just like having Jesus that he is sending, one just like him. Only notice it's forever. This is permanent. And then he calls him in verse 17, that is the Spirit of truth. Remember verse 6 where Jesus said he is the truth? Well, now this other helper, just like him, is going to be the Spirit of truth. He champions the truth. He wants us to understand the truth. He wants us to believe the truth. He wants us to live the truth. He wants us to grow in the truth. And he wants us to pass along the truth. The Spirit champions truth. And I think it's kind of unfortunate that sometimes when people emphasize the Holy Spirit, they either emphasize this subjective experience, or over against that, they emphasize some kind of an objective truth experience. Both are true. We shouldn't drive a wedge here. He's the Spirit of truth, where we experience him as a person, just like Jesus, and that incredibly enriching experience. But he wants to lead us in truth, to experience the truth. This is that one who's going to come as a permanent companion. Another new thought that Jesus lays on him at this time that's going to take a lot of processing is this companion, this divine companion, is going to be within Jesus' followers. We pick this up in the middle part of verse 17 where he says, referring to the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it doesn't see him or know him. The word for see here is a word that emphasized contemplating carefully or looking closely at something, much like a spectator would, that you're engaged in the sport or whatever that you're watching. You are very closely, attentively watching it. Or since it's Memorial Day weekend, we might think of a general who is inspecting and looking at his army and inspecting it very carefully. And this is what's in view here in terms of the world can't see the Holy Spirit in this way, and it certainly doesn't know him by experience. But by contrast, for those who've been saved from their sins, the followers of Jesus, but you know him because he abides with you and will be in you. They know by experience the Holy Spirit because the Holy Spirit has been working from within Jesus and with Jesus. And so as they're with Jesus, they've experienced this person that Jesus is talking about. And so in that way, they'll be familiar. But the radical thing that's going to happen is this person is not going to be just among them or with them. He's going to be inside them. Now, that's going to take more thought, and Jesus is going to have to tell them more about that because this is a novel thought to them. How can this divine companion be in us? And yet, that's the wonderful reality. But the truth is that we as Christians who've got the whole Bible gone for us, we forget that at times too. We act as though it's just us and not the divine companion of the Holy Spirit, that the helper that's inside of us, that's right there doing what we can't do in our own strength. As we think again of Memorial Day week, we can think of the helpers of those who have helped our nation by sacrificing their life and laying down their life to help our nation, and we respect and are grateful for those people. Now Jesus is talking about, hey, I've been your helper, and I'm going to send you a helper just like me. And he's going to be your permanent companion forever. And he's going to be working not just with you, but from inside you as well. One other thought that Jesus lays on them here, which again is going to take more thought to develop, but Jesus in his initial thought talks about him still being present with them. And we pick this up in verse 18, where Jesus says, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. I'm not going to abandon you or leave you as orphans, Jesus is saying. And one way you can understand this, I will come to you, is with the future time and the rapture and second coming, Jesus will come back for his followers, those who will be saved from their sins. I think, though, the context, though, that's a true statement. He will come for us, and that's true. I think the context here demands he will come to us much quicker than that. He will come to us through the Holy Spirit to be with us. He won't abandon us. He didn't abandon them for very long. After he went back to the Father, he came to be with them through the Holy Spirit. You see, just as Jesus talked about in verses we looked at previously, God the Father and God the Son were one in essence. Now we're picking up that God the Son, Jesus, and God the Holy Spirit, they too are one in essence. So to have the one is to have the other. I think sometimes we look at the Holy Spirit as though he's the second string. He's on the bench, and he's second string, and Jesus is first string. God the Father is first string. You got it all wrong. The Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, the helper, he's first string. And to have the Holy Spirit is to have Jesus. And that's what he's saying here. I'm going to be with you. I'm not abandoning you. I'm not leaving you. I am going to be with you. It's just different in how I'm going to be with you. It is through the Holy Spirit that I'm going to be with you. Wow, this opens up a whole new world of spiritual reality, where we realize the Lord Jesus wants to expose us to more and more of this reality and wants us to be open to these truths and then experiencing these heartwarming reality. Now, the truth is, the Spirit of Truth has a lot of lies that he acts to expose in our lives. I imagine that most, if not all of us right now, are believing lies. We don't think they're lies, but we're believing lies. And the Spirit of Truth, the one just like Jesus, he's going to go after those lies. And he's going to expose those lies because he wants you to be led into truth, to experience truth. Will you let him do it? Will you cooperate with him in the truth that he wants to be in your life and lead you into in your life? I think it's appropriate now that we stop and have our time of prayer as we speak to the Father and the Lord Jesus and are aware of what the Spirit of Truth can do at this time. Let's begin with our mission spotlight. Our spotlight today is Brian and Michelle Carrick, is what we're praying for today. And they work with Gospel for Asia. And a lot of stuff has been shut down with what they're doing in Asia. And we just want to pray that God will be working through the virus and through what's happening there to open doors and open hearts and just show Brian and Michelle what they need to be doing in this time and do some mighty things in that area of the world as well. Let's pray. And as we reflect on Memorial Day, we're remembering those who have helped our nation to the ultimate cost of laying down their life for us. Let's thank God for these people and thank God for those who are serving our nation right now and in very much in harm's way. Let's pray that more and more our love would be shown in obedience to Christ's commands. Let's welcome what the Spirit of Truth wants to do in our life, exposing lies, even ones that we haven't realized are lies. But then what he wants to do inside of us after he exposes those lies. And let's pray that we can love Jesus by loving one another so that we won't be quick to judge a brother or sister who has not as strong a conviction as we do about how we should be acting right now. And also pray that those who have a lighter conviction, that they would not be quick to hold in contempt those who have stronger convictions. Father, I thank you for the divine companionship that you give us. Thank you for all that you want to do and continue to do in our life. And I pray, Lord, that the eyes of our heart would be opened, that we would know all the good things that are in us for Jesus' sake. We pray that you will transform us and we will be open to what the Spirit of Truth wants to do in our life. In the precious name of Christ, we pray. Amen. Hey, good to be with you. I look forward to being with you on Tuesday as we go back into this passage of Scripture and hear some more of Jesus' pep talk.